is fascinating history all around us, in every corner of America.
Go out and play and have a good time. You don't have to study all that stuff and mess around, learn all that stuff.
Cause one of these days I'll be born and raised, and it's such a waste to grow up lonely.
Well, there was this fella. You sure you want to hear this story's history?
For Pete's sake, tell the story.
Well, one time, a long time ago.
On one early Sunday morning in the summer of 1840, a group consisting of some of Verona's first settlers left in a wagon from the Campbell Relay House to explore the upper valley of the Sugar River. This included Thomas Stewart, James Young, George and William Brahman, and the Wakefield brothers. The Relay House they departed from was located in Cross Plains and was a stagecoach stopover between Madison and Mineral Point, where Thomas Stewart and James Young were employed. After leaving from the Relay House, the group wound their way down the valley and came across the north end of an elevated prairie. Then, they followed the dividing ridge until they came across 10 mounds. From this spot, they had a splendid view of the surrounding county, and with the mounds being quite prominent and in about the center of the prairie, the group gave this spot the name Nine Mound Prairie.
To the west of Nine Mounds Road, there are actually 10 mounds. There were nine round mounds, and a tenth one shaped like a mammoth. And that's how Nine Mounds Road got its name. A lot of people don't know that now. You can still go out there and see the remnants of one mound. When I was at the newspaper, I wrote an article about it. I went trekking out there and found the last remaining mound. It's right on the fence line out there. And Epic now owns all that land. They've had a geologist out there, or an anthropologist, to figure out where all the mounds are so they don't disrupt what's left of them. But when I went out there, there's one right along the fence line that you could still tell where it was. It was pretty degraded, but you could kind of walk up it, and you went up about maybe a foot and a half. I met with some folks one time, I probably shouldn't say who they were, but when they were kids, they went out and dug up one of the mounds to see if they could find anybody buried in it. They didn't, you know.
There is another account that in 1847, one of these mounds was opened by a man named Dr. Waterbury. On this excursion, a human skeleton was found that was said to have belonged to a person no less than 6 feet 6 inches in height. Accordingly, it was the Native American group, commonly referred to as mound builders, who had shaped these distinct mounds of earth. These first people arrived in southern Wisconsin approximately 10,000 years ago. These early paleo Indians likely hunted woolly mammoth, mastodon, and bison that lived on the abundant vegetation beginning to grow as the glaciers retreated northward. Over the next 13,000 years, these populations evolved and developed complex trade networks which extended to both the Atlantic and Gulf coasts. They lived off the land, farming and hunting and gathering, maintaining strong family ties and cultural traditions within their respective tribes. The presence of European settlers drastically altered their way of life. Between 1640 and 1760, there was much turmoil in the region between the Winnebagoes and their neighbors. Tensions were created when the United States government used tribes against each other to gain more land for white settlers. It was the Treaty of Prairie du Chien which established a treaty of peace among the tribes and established boundaries between white settlers and the Native Americans. By the 1830s, the Winnebagoes had ceded their last rights to the land in the area where Verona is today. However, Section 16 of every township was reserved for the Native Americans by the government. Today, this land is between the Cross Country and Westridge neighborhoods. Early settlers of Verona had a variety of relations and encounters with the Native Americans. Similar to other white pioneers of the time, some traded with them while others feared them and saw them as inferior.
You know, there were stories about, and I'm going to use language I don't usually use here, but there was a guy named Mulhare who used to come to town, and just there was Ho-Chunk Indians here. They called them Winnebago at the time. And, if he saw an Indian, he would just shoot him. And, apparently it was not uncommon to see a corpse of a Native American floating down the Sugar River or the Badger Mill Creek. And the attitude was, oh, Mulhare's been around, there's an Indian floating by. They did not think of them as equal citizens. Mm-hmm. And even through, 50 years before I wrote my book, the attitude was the same. It was like a Western movie where, John Wayne comes in and shoots all the Indians and saves the poor white settlers. We're much more enlightened now. But if you go back and you find the Alice Kunstmann history in the library and you read just the first couple sections, it's really eye-opening. And that's probably, of all the things that I uncovered when I read this book, that was probably the most personally disturbing, because all this stuff exists. But to actually read what people were writing at the time and kind of read their attitude was really, really kind of stunning. And these were probably very nice people. They were just kind of raised to think that the Indians didn't belong here in Verona. And, they were had to be kicked off our land.
Moreover, James Campbell, who came to Wisconsin in 1842, built a little log house on the banks of a ravine in the Verona area. He traded with the Native Americans, and in fact, sometimes as many as 50 of them would camp by his house. By the 1860s, the population of Verona had reached a sizable manor, and the white settlers of the Verona area began to see the Native Americans as too much of a nuisance. So they got together to meet with the Native American chief in the area and requested that they stay away from their settlement. Nearly all of the Native Americans left the Verona area at this time. However, some did continue to stay. In fact, it was recorded that one Native American, known as Big Eagle, died of pneumonia at the Dane County Poor Farm on May 22, 1888. Furthermore, the American Indian was once Verona High School's mascot. In July 1991, a committee of teachers, administrators, and residents recommended to the high school that they change this. A panel was created to study the issue during the course of the 1991 to 1992 school year.
I can tell you this, my recollection, just being, man about town here and reading the news, is that it was fairly non-controversial. Verona was very early in taking the lead. I think there was a Native American living in the district. I think she kind of brought it to the forefront. The subject was brought up, a committee was formed, and there were some, traditionalists who, as happens now in the districts where they consider a change of mascot name, there was some controversy, but not a lot. It was rather just a peaceful transition.
The panel heard testimony from residents on both sides of the issue, from Indian tribal councils from across the state, and from a Native American consultant from the Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction, to name a few. A petition was even given to the panel in favor of keeping the nickname, signed by 1,500 residents. In the end, it was testimony from a group of Native Americans, all members of the Dane County Minority Commission, that solidified public opinion into changing the nickname.
I remember when I was in sixth grade that there was different Native American groups that would come to the school and they would put on presentations. And I remember at least a few of those presentations, and it was they really want us to change it, And then I remember it came up that, okay, now Verona's going to change their mascot, and we need some ideas. And then they had a thing where, I think anybody could just write down whatever they thought might be a good idea.
Suggestion boxes were set up at retail establishments throughout town. After receiving 40 names of suggestions, the committee narrowed the list down to names, including the Eagles, the Flames, the Pony Express, the V-Hawks, the Valiants, and the Wildcats. In March of 1992, a 9-member student committee narrowed the options down, and a vote by all students in the district claimed the winner with 1,145 votes, the Wildcats.
They were saying, oh, the vote's coming, you know, you're going to be voting someday. And then one day at the middle school, everybody was handed a ballot, and that was the list of, and we knew what to expect. You know, we had heard what was coming, but the whole list was there. I can't remember all the things we voted on, but I just remember the one thing that everybody was like, oh my God, how did this make the ballot, was the Pony Express. That was like, everybody was saying, do not vote for Pony Express. How did that even get on the ballot? I don't know if someone actually counted those ballots. You know, I mean, some of those mascots choices were, wow. Wildcats was one of the ones that I felt okay about. And we knew they were voting up at the high school, and we voted for the one, and we didn't really feel strongly about any of them. I think everybody kind of just would have preferred to just stay the same. And we didn't really like any of the options that much. I mean, there wasn't like any options where we were like, oh, this one would be great. This would be better than being the Indians. Nobody felt that way. At least, I mean, not the students. And I remember finding out shortly after we voted, that all the elementary schools also voted. We knew the elementary schools had like way more. So we were like, so the whole fate of our mascot is gonna come down to what a bunch of elementary kids think. And then I found out later, because, you know, 2 years later, now I'm in the high school, and that senior class, they're the ones that, you know, grew up with Indians the whole time, and then all of a sudden got flipped on them, you know, like sophomore year of high school, I think. And they were the most ticked off about it. So most of them would still wear their Indian stuff and, you know, refuse to wear Wildcat stuff. And I remember in their yearbook, I remember that year, maybe it was the year before I was in high school. So when I was in eighth grade, I just saw the yearbook. And it was the transformation. It was like an Indian mascot, and it was transformed until it was a Wildcat or something like that, you know. They wanted that Indian mascot to be part of their yearbook cover because they felt, you know, they identified with that more than they did the Wildcat. I remember even Coach Marks wouldn't put Wildcats on anything. All of the Verona track and cross country stuff would be orange and black, and it would just say Verona. Wouldn't say, you know, a mascot anymore, because he didn't want, you know, because he just didn't want anything with Wildcats on. He's since changed, but it took a while for him. By the time I got to high school, I was fine with the mascot of being Wildcats. I didn't have a problem with it.
The first white settlers came to the Verona area around 1840. It was the two sturdy Scotsmen, Thomas Stewart and James Young, who settled here first. After exploring the upper valley of the Sugar River, they decided to settle on a beautiful flat of land divided by the Badger Mill Creek, less than a mile south of where the city is today. The soil was rich and without stones or obstructions of any kind, while the land was covered with a luxuriant growth of grass and groves of hardwood suitable for building and fencing. Their first home was an excavation into a ridge, which they then roofed with poles and grass. After constructing this shelter, they returned to Cross Plains, where they gathered the rest of their goods. Upon their return, a thunderstorm had swallowed the creek into a river and had washed away the contents of their home. However, they collected what articles they could find and proceeded to build again high above the watermark. This time, they dug horizontally into an Indian mound in which they discovered bones, yet they continued and roofed the excavation with logs and poles, thatching it with grass from the creek, leaving a suitable place for the chimney. They then planted corn and potatoes. However, they soon found out that their provisions were running out. Accordingly, Thomas Stewart set out for supplies in Galena, Illinois, while James Young stayed back, trusting his hunting skills to provide for him. He called his rifle Nicodemus. It had a 6-foot barrel and a bore that could swallow a Springfield rifle. When fully loaded and discharged, it was said that the report would shake the ground and reverberate among the hills and woods for miles. A while later, Thomas returned with adequate provisions, until in 1849, the year of the gold rush, Thomas left for California, never to be heard from again. The third person to settle in the Verona area after Young and Stewart was Samuel Taylor. He built the first log house in Verona near what is currently Pine Row. He was also the owner of the Badger Mill that was constructed in 1843 and 1844 by William Wheeler and George Broman in the valley just south of today's present city along Highway M. In its early years, the area was even known as Taylorville, for Samuel Taylor was elected the town's first chairman at the town's first meeting on April 6, 1847. The meeting was held at a log schoolhouse that was once located a little west of where Farm and Fleet is today. It was also at this meeting in which Verona received its name, after the native township of settlers George and William Broman, who came here from Verona, New York. Verona was also, in its early years, known as the Corners and Verona Corners, due to its location. From west to east went a road from Mineral Point to Milwaukee for hauling minerals to the boats and port, while another road went from south to north from Galena to Green Bay for moving the army. The amount of Scottish immigrants in Verona was so dense that they even called the area between Springdale and Verona Scotch Lane. On October 9, 1843, a Scotch cooperative was organized in the Nine Mound Prairie area. This was recorded as an early successful communist experiment. A group of about 6 men had pooled their earnings and their expenses, divided their belongings and obligations, and bought some land in Section 8 for $3 an acre. This was in fact part of an era of American and European cooperative experiments, especially in America, where pioneer conditions permitted such trials. The Scotch cooperative was dissolved in November 1853. The Scottish immigrants of Verona also influenced early social life in the area. In 1843 and 1844, John Stewart, a younger brother of Thomas, created the famous hooch in an imported still the size of a tea kettle. The quality of the Scotch and the liberal serving practices of the brewer were well known throughout the area. However, one day a couple of Scotsmen who volunteered to help in the drying of the malt found themselves drinking the whiskey to pass the time. They left the kiln and malt to dry with a fire still blazing. When they returned, all had burned to ashes. In 1846, the first 4th of July celebration in Dane County outside of Madison was held in Verona. They enjoyed the Scottish whiskey, played Scottish games, and danced to the bagpipes of Billy Roach. Indeed, the Scotch had a great influence on the early settlement of Verona, but like the rest of America, the area was surely a mixing pot of cultures.
You know, initially it was people from eastern U.S. If you look at the old census records, you see, you know, New York, Pennsylvania, eastern states, so they were primarily of people from the British Isles. Then later came, that's where some of my ancestors came into the picture, you know, kind of the 1870s, I think, especially in the 1880s, Germans came to the area. My dad's dad was born in Prussia, now part of Poland. He came as a little boy. So I envision it initially settled by English-speaking people from the eastern U.S. and then came Germans. So I just find it, I guess, interesting to think about how that worked when these non-English speakers, thinking about today with, you know, the Latino population, you know, moving into the area, and some of the language barriers that go on in our schools, for example. How did that work with the kids coming in speaking German? I know how they handled it in the churches, for example. St. James Lutheran Church was founded by Germans, and the services were in German. My dad's baptismal certificate is written in German. And of course, some Norwegians came in into the area, maybe a little bit more toward the southwestern part of Dean County, but some of that overlapped into the area. Gradually, some of the Swiss kind of, were a fringe area of Green County.
Most of Verona early settlers were Swiss. And there were a lot of cheese factories around Verona, so cheese making was a very important industry around Verona, and of course agriculture.
So I don't know, I find that interesting, certainly maybe not the most interesting aspect of history, but the fact that the English speakers then came the other ethnic groups, and I just think the Germans and Norwegians, of course, so east into Fitchburg came Irish later, so it became much more of a mixed ethnic area. And I kind of wonder how they all kind of merged, with the, I suspect that the German farm community, was a community unto itself. I just kind of imagine that. So I find that interesting that this is not exclusive to Verona, of course, obviously. It's just how it happened, I think, in many communities in Dane County, probably.
Yak bita hita, bata boo, bata boo. Nina oche, bata boo.
Oh, I went to what was then called Verona State Graded School. That was the name. And you understand schools were organized differently than they are now. So that school is the brick school on West Verona Avenue that is currently the New Century School. It existed as a standalone. It's connected to Sugar Creek, but it was just that was the only school in Verona itself. Within at that time was the village of Verona. So kids from the village itself, and then some of the rural areas, including where I lived in Cross Country Road, were part of that grade school district. And so we were going to the big school, with I don't know how many kids there were, pretty much just one classroom per grade. The surrounding area had numerous, there probably were 10, I could recite them if I thought about it, but they call them country schools. They were primarily one room. There were a couple of them that had a couple of classrooms, but all of the surrounding area of what is now the Verona Area School District was composed of little tiny school districts run by, in those cases, primarily farmers. They would have, they were neighborhood schools, and all the kids, and I don't think any of them had kindergarten in the rural schools. But so the outlying kids of most of the rural area went to these small schools. One classroom, the teacher taught everybody. There might be one eighth grader, or 2 8th graders, or 3 5th graders, whatever it is, but they were all neighbors. Mentioned that they had all these little rural school districts with, I think most of them had like 3 people on the school board. Well, there was a separate high school board too. They're separate entity actually. So it was, I would say, probably 1962, 63, right about that point where this consolidation occurred, where the current school district was formed, combining all of the rural elementary school districts and the high school district into one consolidated school district.
What did they call it? Consolidation, it was called. In fact, I was on the school board of the elementary school. There were 2 school boards. It was an elementary school board and a high school board. And the elementary school board only dealt with that school where the charter school is now. And there was a movement throughout the state to start to consolidate school districts and to close rural schools, one-room schoolhouses and so forth. And it was a tough sell. I got off the board, my term ran out, and I decided that the consolidation issue was bigger than me. I mean, I didn't think I wanted to face up to all that. I was a coward, I guess. But I decided not to run. And a guy by the name of Ken Zing, a local fellow here, ran and won that position and stayed on for the board for many, many years. He was very good on the board. But at any rate, it was very controversial because all of the rural schools, that was a community kind of thing. And they gave up reluctantly to consolidate, and all of those children then, as those schools started to close, were bused into Verona, into town.
So it was about that point. When I started as a freshman in high school, a lot of the kids I'd never seen before because they went to the rural school. Some of them just due to other associations around town I knew, but a lot of the kids I'd never seen before. So after that point, then they gradually started closing down those rural schools. Starting in all 63, after 63-ish, I think they were still operating at that point. And within a couple of years, probably, they were mostly closed.
One or two schools stayed open for a while. Valley View out here and went into town, and Maple Grove, maybe you know about that, another on Maple Grove Road, stayed open for a while, but I think those were the only two that really stayed open very long. And then they eventually closed too, and all the students came to Verona. And then they expanded the grade school and it became Sugar Creek. But that took a while for all that to happen. But yeah, that was not easy, easy time. There were a lot of rural school districts, and they liked their districts and they liked their community, and it was a tough sell.
Most of them are occupied as residents. You got the Gordon School, the residence. White School is just sits there. And Valley View School is used as a kind of a, I don't know, auto body repair business. I'm not sure exactly that nature of business. McPherson School on Highway G is a residence toward Mount Vernon. Continuing our tour, Maple Corners School on Highway M is a residence. As you're driving toward Oregon, somebody lives there. Stoner School on Roman Road, and corner of Roman Road and Fitchburg Road. Note the connection, Stoner Prairie. It was named after Mr. Stoner, and it turned out that I believe the history is that a guy by the name of Stoner was the first farmer in Fitchburg, although he never lived in Fitchburg. He came out from Madison to his farm, and they call that flat area out there Stoner's Prairie. So when they were, a little deviation here, but when they were looking for the name of schools, I submitted the suggestion of Stoner's Prairie. They thought, oh, that's a little bit too much of a name. So they simplified to Stoner Prairie. So that's, but there was a Stoner's School, so it's not entirely a new name. So that's why, because that physically was the area of Stoner's Prairie. And then Camp Badger School, you know where that is, on Highway PD, just past the AMC Theater on the right.
Yeah.
That's most of them. And of course, Verona State Graded School, as they call it, is now, that's being used as a New Century School.
Woodman Hall was part of the Woodman's Association. It was an old club, goes way back, and had to do with lumbering and tree farming and that kind of thing. And they had a building on the corner of Park Avenue and Schumann, kind of right to the west of Ace Hardware. It was a wood building, one story, had a basement, and a furnace in the basement with a great big round grate in the middle of the floor, and a basketball court upstairs. And they used it for meetings, they used it for dances, a lot of things. But it served as a basketball court for the high school. And other things until 1938, when the new high school was, I say new high school was built. To prove I'm right, I don't need to be forgiven. Yeah, 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 yeah,
So that was on South Marietta Street. It was a two-story building with a little bell steeple, I guess you call it, a little bell thing on top. And if you know where West Park Lane is, if you go straight west, you'll see still, I think, a little bit of a driveway that goes off of the school district still owns that right away onto the playground area. So the high school was just south of that little driveway. That was the original high school.
But the high school did not have a basketball court prior to 1938, when the building was built that I went to school in. That was built by the WPA, an old agency during the Depression.
And then the high school was brand new, almost. It was what's now the K wing, but only one wing where the offices, only that wing. There were not two wings in the cable. So that was Verona High School. It wasn't Verona, they didn't call it Verona Area High School yet. It was Verona High School.
Well, we didn't have as many as you have today. We had football, basketball, and for 2 years of my high school years, we had boxing, and we had baseball. We played baseball behind the old high school where Sugar Creek Apartments are now, and football too. That was a football field also.
The first ever state championship was when Coach Marks had the 74 cross-country team win the state championship. That was the first ever team state title that Verona had won. One of the interesting stories, that I was definitely not around for this team, but this is another Coach Marks you know. The WIA added women's sports, I think, like 1979 or 1980, something like that. And that was the first year that they were going to have, you know, girls compete in high school. And I only know this from stories told, not from personal experience. I mean, I wasn't even in Verona. I was like 1 year old, you know. But his, when he found out, so at the time he's coaching boys cross country and boys track. So now he's told, you're going to be also coaching girls cross country and girls track now. And he's like, okay, you know, whatever. So when the girls came out that year, he had never coached girls before. So he's just like, well, I'll just coach them just like I coach the boys. So he had them doing the same mileage, same workout, same everything. And he says now he can't believe those girls didn't get injured because, you know, typically they train at a, you know, little bit less training volume, like, you know, like I think 20% or 30% less volume. And, but no, he just plugged them, same mileage as the boys and everything, you know. And he said the reason they were so good that year is because they were tough enough to handle the training. And they won the inaugural state championship in girls cross country. They were the first ever state champions for cross country. And I believe that was the first sport that awarded. I mean, I you could have to ask Coach Marks to be sure, but I think it might have been the first sport that was ever awarded a girls state title. I mean, between boys cross country, girls cross country, boys track and girls track, and he doesn't have all of those because he didn't coach girls track for all of their state titles, but some of them I know. At that point, I think he was at, you know, like 8 or 9 state titles between all of those. And he coaches would still kind of criticize him, you know, the bigger schools would say, oh, yeah, wait till you get into Division I, then we'll see if you can win a state title. Well, so they got moved into Division I in 93 and, you know, never had a really great team. And then 98, we had a very good team, a lot of guys coming back. And then 99, yeah, they made the magic happen. They worked really hard. They had the talent and they made it happen and won Verona's ever first Division I state championship. For a while, it seemed like that would be the only team that would ever win one because it just, you know, didn't seem like anybody else was going to make it happen. But then girls soccer won. Football got really close. They were the state runner-up. I guess that was Division II, but, I mean, it's almost like you have two Division I's, you know, if you look at it that way. And then hockey won it last year, and then girls golf. So it's like now it seems like, you know, hey, we really belong in, you know, in Division I.
Well, unfortunately, Verona is not known for retaining buildings that could be perceived by some, at least, to have historical value. It's a shame, but it's a fact. So the most prominent one, and there are a lot of people in town who still, you can get an emotional response if you bring up the Dr. Sharp house.
And there was a building right across the street here called the Sharp House. And it was a big, old Victorian house.
Well, it was right there.
Really?
It was right behind the park bank. It was a very nice lot, set back off the road on both sides, big pine trees. It was quite impressive.
But it was a beautiful grounds. It was kind of a creamy brick house. It occupied the whole block from Main Street to Schumann Street. I think there was a garage. It maybe had been where they kept the horses, you know, in the old days. I'm not sure, but it was certainly the garage. And it was almost like a park. I know it had a lot of evergreen trees and large lawn.
Dr. Sharp was our only physician early on. Then later, Dr. Weiland came. But Dr. Sharp had, originally he would go on house calls with a horse and buggy. But after that he had a big black Buick. And it was just he and his wife, his son. By the time I came to Verona, his son had already left the home. And actually he became a doctor in Perdichine, his son. Doc Sharp was a typical old-time sawbones kind of doctor, very basic kind of doctor. Sewed people up, and of course medicine was in its infancy, you know, really. And but he had a practice in the house and was very successful. They were an interesting couple. Kind of kept to themselves, didn't really socialize very much around town. She wore black all the time, I can remember that. She always dressed in black, and that was kind of unusual. But when they left the garage with the big Buick, it was kind of spectacular because there weren't any big Buicks around Verona. If anybody had a car, it was an old Ford or old Chevy or something, you know.
Can you imagine that house sitting in downtown Verona, southwest corner of Verona Avenue and Main Street? There's nothing wrong with the Capital Bank building. I'm not, you know, criticizing anything that's there now, but I'm just saying. It was, Dr. Sharp was a physician in town. I think he died in the 1940s. When I was a kid, the place was kind of a mystery because Mrs. Sharp, the widow, lived there. Well, it seemed a little spooky, you know, but you'd see light in the house, but I don't know that I ever saw Mrs. Sharp. I was, you know, what, that woman that lives in that house. But, and that's the villa, that it's the local government's fault because it was Mrs. Sharp, for whatever reason, the decision was made. She was still living and the property was to be sold. I went to the auction and she had left, this is probably in the 60s, I believe she left the doctor's office just the way it was from back in the 40s. They were selling all of the, you know, all the instruments and everything from the doctor's office that I think she had left everything intact. But at any rate, I think she moved to her son's place out of state. And the village at that time, again, of course, is the village government structure, not city, but the village bought that house and used it as a village hall for some time. Then they sold it to private interests. And then it was torn down to make way for a Hardee's restaurant. So it was quite a bit of outrage. I mean, you can't blame the private interests. They bought it, but it's the village had it in there. It was in the public domain. They let it slip away. And that would be today, had that not been destroyed, would probably be being used in every publicity picture that they would be using to promote Verona.
It was a beautiful house, but in the middle of downtown there was no good commercial use for it, and they tore it down, and there was the elementary school kids came out and protested, you know, had signs and stuff. It was in the front of the Verona Press. It was really kind of interesting.
I remember that the people went down and picketed. Teachers were going to go down there, and remember at the time, you know, it's just one elementary school. So teachers were going to go down there, students were going to go down there. But, I mean, even at that age, I was kind of like, sounds like this is kind of a done deal. So, but yeah, I remember it was a big deal for a lot of people. And it's been remained that way for a long time. I mean, Hardee's was there for, gosh, at least 10 years, I want to say. And there were still people 10 years all the way up until they went out. People that when they did go out of business, like, good, I'm glad they went out of business.
The problem is that Verona doesn't have much of a downtown, and the historic buildings aren't very usable. They're not very useful for modern businesses. The things that we built a long time ago, Verona was not built with a downtown in mind. Like if you go to Mount Horeb, you can see all those kind of storefronts are along the street with the apartments above them and that kind of thing. Verona's not built like that. We have houses downtown. You know, buildings that were built for old-time businesses where you had your old general store in the front. There's only one room. But there was just no real way to make that house into something that you could use in the downtown, convert it to a business application. Over on South Main Street, about a block down, there was a building, and I noticed there was the facade in the front, and looked like a normal building. Then there's this big, long, straight thing coming off the back of it. And I thought to myself, who would build a building like that? It was just like a one-story kind of long extension off the back of this building, and I couldn't figure out what it was. And I eventually met the owner, and it was the original bowling alley in Verona. So, you know, you had kind of an area in front where you came in, and you had a little bar, and you paid, and then you went back to the lanes, and the lanes were what stretched back, and that's why there was this big, long extension off the building. But, you know, how is a business going to use a big, long, four-lane bowling alley? That's all it was. The same thing, Walgreens had one of the older houses in Verona on its site, and they tore that down.
It was another building, which would be great to have it there today. I don't know how it would work out, but it's in Miller's parking lot, corner of Church Avenue and South Main Street. When it was torn down, the name was Salem United Church of Christ. Originally, it was a Methodist church, and then the denomination went through various name changes, but it was Salem United Church of Christ. They built the new church, which is now in the 60s, Mark Drive, and it was sold to Miller's and Keith Miller, and torn down, naturally. The congregation sold it, so what was he going to do with it? But that it was a... I would think of it as a white New England style church with a tall steeple. There was another house where the current State Bank of Cross Plains is. That was the new Bank of Verona. The original Bank of Verona was on the corner, a two-story brick building at the corner. Well, it's now the Walgreens parking lot of North Main and West Verona Avenue. Probably the late 50s, maybe, that was torn down. I suppose it'd be great to have that building, but maybe not too practical.
The telephone company was upstairs in the bank building. There was also a post office in that bank building. And you had an operator who received your call and then plugged in on a panel board your cord into the cord for the number you were calling. If I was calling phone number 50, she would get my call. That would be from 107. Then 107, and it was a plug with a cord on it, and she would plug it into 50, and then you were connected. And that's how you talked to the other party. In front of her was a deck with all of these plugs sticking up. And she had to pretty much know where all of them were. I'm sure they were in some sequential order. But she would pick that up and then plug it into the number you were calling. Mm-hmm. And it was standard procedure that you didn't call on the telephone after 10 o'clock to wake her up. She slept right next to that board. And if there was a fire or anything, you know, she had to be there to make that connection, because that's what made that siren go off. She had a lot of responsibility. And then somebody from the fire department would have to call her to ask, where's the fire?
Then the Bank of Verona, which was a smaller version of what's there now, was built. There were was one large frame house that has been torn down, and then there was another brick house that had been built, well back into the 1800s, that was torn down. It's kind of a companion house to the brick house that still does exist at the northeast corner of that intersection.
And now the Matt's house, which is on the corner of the intersection here, which is the oldest house in Verona, the owner, Josiah H.B. Matt's, was the person who kind of developed the entire downtown area in Verona. It's falling apart.
And I know the city is trying very hard to find a tenant for that building who can preserve the building, because it's our oldest kind of last remaining historic building in town. But unfortunately, as you're looking for something useful in the downtown, something like a business that could go there, and the building just wasn't built for a business. So you run the risk of having this vacant building there just so you can have it, because it's historic, or tearing it down and putting up something more useful to the modern Verona. And that's the struggle that we face here in town. You know, so we haven't done a great job of preserving our history, but on the other hand, if we want to become a modern community, there's just struggles. You have to make a decision if you want to preserve or become modern. And in a lot of the cases, we've had to have the choice of preserving just to preserve. There's no other really good use for the buildings.
My name is John W. Scherer. I was born in Monroe, came to Verona at age 5 in 1936, and my family ran the Eagle's Nest, which was down on the main intersection of Verona, for 30 years. We lived upstairs in that building, and so I was pretty well acquainted with downtown Verona. Verona was about 400 to 425 people when we came here, and it stayed that way until after World War II, when there started to be a little more growth. The veterans came back from World War II and started building houses little by little, but it grew very slowly.
I have lived in Verona for 29 years now. I moved here in 1986. I always tell folks that depending on which end of town you came in on, there were two different populations. To the north, it was 3,500, and to the south, it was 4,100. The signs said two different things.
Verona's changing so much.
I know.
I mean, when I was younger, it was kind of under control, you know, but I was like, Ken Behnke, and I have lived in Verona all of my life. Grew up on a cross-country road on a farm. My dad farmed until I was about 5 or 6 years old. But then my grandparents, my mother's parents, had a farm across the road, the Zing farm. And after my dad quit farming, then they rented our farm. So it was kind of like two farmhouses, but one big farm. So I kind of basically grew up in a dairy farm, more or less.
Now, at the time, Verona was growing, but we were still not way bigger than, you know, Mount Horeb or Belleville and some of these other schools that now we consider to be smaller schools than what we are.
Most of the businessmen were active in trying to promote more growth in Verona, but it came very slow. And so, well, that's kind of how it went until we got into the 50s and 60s. It started to gradually get to be a little more of a community. We were still a village then. We were incorporated.
If you can imagine where the Quick Trip is now, and those two houses just behind it, there was nothing to the east of that. You know, no Culvers, no fire station, no anything like that. The only thing there was the Dane County home, which was much bigger and more Gothic looking. To the west, there was, you know, no Westridge Estates. To the north, everything kind of stopped at Cross Country Road.
Verona, in the time I was growing up as a little guy, was not very much. We were always considered a bedroom for Madison. Everybody shopped in Madison for clothes, shoes, and most essentials. We had grocery stores, and we had not much else for people to buy. It was pretty old time.
When I came to town, the bypass wasn't here yet. all the traffic came right through the center of town. It was just a little two-lane rickety street, and it got so bad. I mean, traffic would be backed up sometimes during rush hour. People going like towards Mount Horeb would be from the central stoplight to past where Culver's and those places are now, waiting to get through the one stoplight in the middle of Verona.
We had taverns, we had bowling alley, we had a lot of other things. I remember that people used to come to town in horse and buggies. We had hitching rails in front of the grocery stores.
There was electrical wires along the street. They since buried them. The quick trip that we have now in Verona was just a little shack, really. It was tiny little white shed of a building with two gas pumps out front. And it looked like if you leaned on the gas pumps, they were going to fall over.
Model T's, Model A's, Model B's, and some of the cars through the 30s were pretty primitive. They were just a tad better than a horse and carriage, really.
Probably some of the most interesting parts of the stories of Verona involved the fact that the railroad went through town. And we were a big railroad stop, and we were also kind of a crossroads on the way to Mineral Point.
Well, I'm just old enough to remember a steam engine. And there's a sound I wish I would have recorded, because I can remember the sound of the steam engine whistle when the train went through. I was really little. And then, of course, it was replaced with the diesel locomotive.
There was a place just right on the corner called the Eagle's Nest. That was, bar, restaurants, you name it. Some illegal activities happened there. So.
The guy that was here at the Eagle's Nest before we came managed to violate the law pretty regularly. But he also, in order to enhance his income, he hooked up with a syndicate in Chicago of car hijackers and car thieves, and they would run him up to Verona and into the Green Barn and repaint them, redo the upholstery maybe, make them look different, and then sell them on the black market. And as a result of that, he ended up spending some time in Waupun State Prison. My parents did a good job of keeping it clean and up to date, and the Eagle's Nest became a very, I shouldn't say famous, but it became a destination. Most of the people that ate their food at the Eagle's Nest were from Madison. I think a lot of people in Verona thought it was a little too exclusive. We had linen tablecloths and linen napkins. The waitresses all wore uniforms, and it was well known as a place that had uneven floors. There was quite a drop from one end of the bar to the other end of the bar. A person that was 6 foot would become about 5'5" on the other end of the bar. And behind that was the back bar where we had all the liquor and rent stinks and all that we had to do in doing the business.
The nightlife scene here was actually kind of cool. There was the auditorium building, that was just a hopping place. People getting off the train and staying there. There was a story. I met a guy who was involved in during Prohibition, and a government raid over at the old auditorium. The revenuers came in and busted him for selling illegal alcohol. There's lots of fun stories around it. The old folks had a really good time. They did some wild things.
Give me my badge and gun. Give me the road that I may run. Give me that peaceful wandering free I used to know. I've waited all I can, but I'm just not a patient man. Man, I've been hiding here for 7 months or so. Hand me down my coat and hat, grab the wind. nights alone. Those lay down nights alone. This house is safe and warm, but I was made to chase the storm. Taking the whole world on with big old empty arms. Tell my friends I tried my best, that one day I just up and left. They probably saw it coming anyway.
What can I say?
Hey, hey.
Understand dependence when you know their maker's land. So make your sirens call and sing all you want. I will not hear what you have to say, 'cause I